Hello, Mr. Rocker speaking, and it's just 10 days away before E3 comes out, and possibly word on who's next to be DLC for Super Smash Bros. For Wii U and Nintendo 3DS. So you all remember the Smash Bros. Fighter ballot, right? Came out in April and lasts till October, and you can nominate your favorite video game characters, like, Shrek. Okay, whatever. Now, I understand a lot of people are taking this chance to nominate characters that could have been during Melee or Brawl, but would they have that same chance nowadays? Well, I'm going to approximate that by looking back at the previous Smash Brothers titles and what kind of pattern they have with their newcomers. In the end, though, this is really just going to be a theory. I'm not going to say it. So, take this with a grain of salt, as per usual. So, in each Smash Brothers game, I've noticed there are two kinds of newcomers introduced. Catch-up and relevance. Now, when I define these categories, I speak, of course, during the time that the game itself was released. Catch-up is used for characters whose representation in Smash has been around for quite a while in Nintendo's history. And yes, this is a running trend for all the games, especially the rule of retro, that is, a character that's been around in the 8-bit era, is in effect. Relevance applies to characters whose representation in Smash was introduced in a time that was after the previous Smash Bros. Title. This applies to characters that were introduced in such a time, or if the character was introduced before but got it redesigned during that time that's used in Smash. But you can break the newcomers into two other kinds of groups. That is, standalone and what I'm gonna call polyrep. Standalone is used for characters that are introduced into a brand new solo group in that game. Polyrep applies to newcomers that go into an already existing group. So here's what's gonna happen. I'm gonna look at each Smash Brothers title and look at the newcomers introduced in that game, first going with the standalones and splitting those into catch-up and relevance, and then doing the same for polyreps. Sound good? Okay, let's start. Oh, you want me to start with the first game? Well, this is the very first Super Smash Brothers, so it technically doesn't have any newcomers yet. Though I suppose relevance was a big factor for at least two of the characters introduced here, namely Captain Falcon and Ness. The two of them did appear in SNES titles and were introduced as unlockable characters. A star from a relatively new racing title, and the protagonist of a cult hit RPG. To a lot of people, these two really stood out. I suppose Pikachu and Jigglypuff also qualify because their game, Pokemon, was introduced during the SNES's time. As well as Star Fox, which also started on the SNES. Their relevance at the time got them into Smash Brothers, and they've been stuck in ever since. Anyway, that's just the beginning. Let's proceed onward. Skip forward 4 years, and we got Super Smash Bros. Melee! Yep, 4 years. There wasn't many new faces to scrounge up during that era. So, I'd say catch-up was the biggest factor for the new faces in this title. Especially with the two new standalone characters introduced here. The Ice Climbers and Mr. Game & Watch. These guys date way back. Especially Old Man Game & Watch. He's been around since Nintendo started video gaming. I would put Marth here since Fire Emblem was also a new group in this game, but there was another character joining him, so no, he'll have to count as a polyrep here. As for new polyreps, there's lots joining the already existing groups. Peach, Bowser, Dr. Mario, Zelda, Sheik, Ganondorf, Young Link, Mewtwo, Falco, and the previously mentioned Marth. All of these are catch-up polyreps. They've been around since before the first Smash Brothers. In fact, I'm pretty sure Bowser and Mewtwo were meant to be in the first one. But two polyrep newcomers were more modern at the time. I'm talking about Pichu and Roy. Pichu was the clone brought in to represent Pokemon's new second generation. As for Roy, well, the spot for a Marth clone was originally going to go to Leif from Thracia 776, the most recent Fire Emblem game at the time. But then Sakurai saw the design for Roy, protagonist of the upcoming Binding Blade, and decided to use that instead. Sorry, Leif. You'll never get a taste of the Smash action now. So yeah, as the first sequel in the Smash Brothers series, Melee had to catch up on a lot of faces, but could only add two modern ones. But this isn't the only sequel now, is it? Let's proceed onward through time, 6 years later. Super Smash Brothers Brawl. Here we see newcomers that are half catch-up and half relevant. The relevance factor is just starting to take over. So first, standalone catch-up. We have Olimar, Pit, Rob, Snake, and Sonic. Rob and Pit are classics, but Pit was intended to be in since the beginning, but they could never animate his wings right in the past two games. Technical limitations could also be why they're only now bringing in Olimar when he existed in the GameCube just before Melee released. In fact, Snake was actually meant to be in Melee, but when they got the idea to, it was too late, so they had to hold him off until Brawl. As for Sonic, well, he was only brought in because they're bringing in third-party characters now.
Wait, what about Mario? Didn't he exist before Melee? Wouldn't that make him catch up too?
Well, normally, but look again. Wario's default design and parts of his moveset come from the WarioWare series, which did not exist at Melee's time. And the design was probably used as Wario's default to point out that Wario is in his own group separate from the Mario group. So, since a new design served as the basis for Wario's playstyle, he counts as a relevant standalone. Now let's look at the new Polyreps. So we got Diddy Kong, DDD, Meta Knight, Wolf O'Donnell, and the Pokemon Trainer, with Squirtle, Ivysaur, and Charizard. These all have been around since the first Smash Brothers game, but are only now being brought in. Like Pit, DDD was also meant to be in the first game, and Wolf was also intended to be the Fox clone in Melee, before getting switched out with Falco. As for more relevant Polyreps, we have Toon Link, Lucario, Zero Suit Samus, Lucas, and Ike. Toon Link is technically Young Link in the most recent Young Link design, which comes from Wind Waker, from the GameCube. Zero Suit Samus' appearance comes from Zero Mission, a Metroid 1 remake on the Game Boy Advance. As for Lucario, Lucas, and Ike, they came from games that were the most recent of their series. That is, Pokemon 4th Generation, Mother 3, and Fire Emblem Path of Radiance, and the upcoming Radiant Dawn. Come to think of it, you all know about the Forbidden Seven, right? Seven characters that apparently didn't make it into the final cut. This includes Mewtwo, Dr. Mario, and Roy from Melee, who didn't make it, and Toon Zelda, Toon Sheik, Dixie Kong, and Plusslin Minun. Now, Dixie alone would have counted as catch-up, but the other three? Toon Zelda and Toon Sheik probably refer to the two forms of Tetra, the pirate from Wind Waker. As for Plusslin Minun, they probably would have been introduced as representatives for Pokemon's third generation, filling in the two generations that were introduced after Melee. In any case, I fear these four would have been newcomers, might have missed their boat here. So, let's proceed onward to the next title, our current one, Super Smash Bros. For Wii U and Nintendo 3DS. But first, the fourth game's catch-up standalones. Besides third-party guests Mega Man and Pac-Man, we have the Villager from Animal Crossing, the Wii Fit Trainer, and the duo known as Duck Hunt. Ever since an Animal Crossing stage was added in Brawl, people have wondered why there wasn't an Animal Crossing rep. Well, here's Villager. And of course, Wii Fit Trainer was added right away as the curveball character.
And Duck Hunt?
Rule of Retro. But Little Mac and Shulk qualify for relevance. The revival that Punch-Out got on the Wii really helped Little Mac's odds in getting into the roster now. For Shulk, well, Xenoblade Chronicles was one of the biggest RPGs to ever hit the Wii, so the relevance factor was pretty obvious there. Okay, let's look at the Polyreps. Whoa! this is practically all relevance. Look at this, we got Greninja from Pokemon 6th Generation, Robin and Lucina from Fire Emblem Awakening, most recent Fire Emblem game, Palutena and Darkpick as presented in Kid Icarus Uprising, looks and abilities wise, and of course Bowser Jr. as presented in-
Whoa, hold up! Wouldn't Bowser Jr. count as catch-up? Because he's been around since the GameCube.
Yes, but like with Wario, it's the concept he's presented with in Smash that defines him as irrelevant. Look at him, and the Koopalings. All 8 of them share the same roster slot, meaning they're all teamed up. And what are they riding? Junior Clown Cars. That was Bowser Jr.'s preferred weapon in...
the new Super Mario Bros. Series!
Correct! From pilots to gameplay, Bowser Jr. and the Koopalings are appearing as they have in the new Super Mario Bros. Series, starting on New Super Mario Bros. Wii.
Okay, but what about Rosalina? Would she be catch-up, since Super Mario Galaxy came out just before Brawl did?
True, but Galaxy did come out after Brawl's roster development, so it's actually too close to call. So I guess I'll have to call Rosalina very relevant catch-up. But of all the new Polyreps, Rosalina is the only one that's close to catch-up. So, here's the conclusion I've come to. New standalones? It doesn't seem to matter which era they come from, so long as they're forming a new solo group. But as for the new Polyreps, they seem to be all about relevance now.
Oh, what does this mean for the fighter palette?
Well, you're free to make a choice, but in the end, who actually gets in as DLC is up to the Smash staff. And it looks like who actually gets in will be based on certain criteria, like what I might have found here. So, who do I think would be most likely to make it in? Now, I won't be naming off any standalones since they have free time range, going from Inklings or Isaac or Mike Jones or whatever. So I'll just look at new Polyreps and see who might be added to existing groups. Of all the popular Mario choices, the most relevant seems to be Captain Toad. And, you know, he can actually work. For Zelda, I think the most likely one in relevance that's not an assist trophy would be Impa, as in Skyward Sword or Hyrule Warriors. So I'd hate to rain on the K Rule Parade, but given this, I think it's even less likely that he's actually going to appear as playable. I mean, come on, his last appearance was in Mario Super Sluggers.
But Kremlings!
Yes, I get it, the Kremlings appeared in Smash Run. You know what, Devil Car did too, and I don't see Nintendo in the game. Now, to me, the title of most likely DK newcomers will have to go to Dixie Kong and Cranky Kong, as per their playable appearances in Tropical Freeze. As for the Wario group, relevance could apply to any character who's got something new in Game & Wario. Like maybe Mona, she could use her photography skills along with other occupations. Heck, incorporate Rhythm Heaven somewhere into her moveset. She is a rocker after all. Bandanity deserves a bone here since he got a lot more attention after Return to Dreamland. And I'd hate to say it, but I think the most likely Metroid newcomer they're gonna think up is anyone from Metroid M. Probably Anthony. Or if they announce a new Metroid game at E3 this year, they can pull someone from that. In the off chance that we do get another Pokemon DLC character, I'd say it would be anyone from the 5th generation, since Brawl attempted to get a 3rd gen rep in. Or possibly one of the more advertised Pokemon from Omega Ruby and Alpha Sapphire, which, after counting off any Pokemon that are in Pokeballs or stages, leaves us with Skeptile and Swampert.
Oh, it's superior.
And really, this gets me worried if we'll ever see a Star Fox newcomer like Crystal. Unless they bring out the new Star Fox game at E3, in which case, I think the relevance factor will go up. Maybe they'll have a new design for Crystal in that game. And for Fire Emblem, given the rule of relevance that is shown for every character that's not Marth, I'd say for DLC, they would go with Kamui from Fire Emblem If. Besides, Kamui can turn into a dragon. After we got a Majin, Fire Emblem could use a shapeshifter. As for the other existing groups, they don't have anyone that would count in the relevance factor, unfortunately. So, we're done here. So what do I think about Smash 4's DLC? Well, new standalones, anything goes. But for new Polyreps, it seems relevance is going to be the big factor here. Either way, I hope they pick out some real winners. Might we see any of them in E3? Or later? I suppose we'll see in due time. Until then, later!